Hello, in this video lecture I am going to cover the remaining part of the testing, VLSI testing. So in that, first one is parallel scan. So in the previous scan method, that is scan design, it works in a two mode. One is scan mode, another one is normal mode. In the normal mode, flip-flop inputs are driven by the actual circuit, but in scan mode, since we have used the MUX, in the scan mode all the flip-flops form a giant shift register, or they are connected serially. So it will take a lot of time, or it requires n number of clock pulses to go through all the flip-flops, so the testing time will be more here. So to reduce this delay, we can use parallel scan. So in the parallel scan, each register or each flip-flop is connected to a column line and row line. So the which flip-flop you want to control or observe, that one, the address of that flip-flop has to be issued. That means you have to give proper write and proper row and column data. So there will be row decoder and column decoder. It is similar to memory, where we will give the address so that we can access the location. Similarly, whichever flip-flop we want to control or observe, we will use the address line and we will select a particular that flip-flop. So here it is shown. In this, four flip-flops are shown and column lines are shown and row lines, okay, and each this memory element is shown here. So each memory element will have these inputs and components. So let us see that how this works, this memory element, how this works. So let us consider the memory element and we will see how it works. So let me, so I have taken the circuit diagram of individual flip-flop. So you will have column line and a row line, and there will be a universal line called data and a universal signal write. So suppose if you want to select a particular flip-flop, you have to issue the proper row and column address. So when the proper row and column lines are issued, that means the flip-flop which we have considered should have row equal to 1 and column equal to 1. So you have column value 1, row value 1. That means in this one, this value is 1, and the column means this will be 1. Similarly, column is this, correct, this one, row is 1, and these two signals, okay, correct, this is column and row. So then this value will be 1 and get will be 1. Now we have to, suppose we would like to write some data, or we would like to control the value. So that time the universal write will be 1. So this write value will be 1. However, the flip-flop which is going to get affected is the chosen one or selected one. So here what happens when write equal to 1, let me write here, this will be 1. Since that same length, the write is this is the write signal. So one input is going here, another one is here, and output is 0. Okay. So now we will see what are the output we will get here. So since this is 0, this output will be 0. So this will be 0. And since this AND gate output is 1 and 1, and you have given this, the column line is 1, so this AND gate will be 1. So that means this will be 1. So if this is 1, in this MUX, this is a MUX where 0th line is a D and first input line is the data. So whatever value you give here at the data, so that will be fed to the flip-flop. So this data, you can see here, this is the data. So from here, via MUX, it is stored, it will be stored in the flip-flop. So that one you will observe here. That one, sorry, not observe, that one you will get here. Q value will be here. So here you will get the data. This will be data. So now this data line used as a input now, because we have taken the value from this data line and fed to the flip-flop. Now if you want to read that, then what you have to do is you have to issue the write signal as zero. So once you issue zero, so let me draw this. So once zero is issued, so this will be zero and this will be one. Now this value will be one. So what happens now, only this will change. Write will be zero means now this will be zero. So these two outputs will change. This is 1 and 1. So you will get 1. Since this is 0 now, 0 and 1. So you will get 0 here. So that time what happens? This is a tri-state buffer. So tri-state buffer, previously it was getting 0. That's why this was in high impedance state. Now since it is changed from 0 to 1, here also I have to change, this is 1. Now this tri-state buffer is enabled, and whatever value is given, whatever value is stored in this, it will be written in this line. So data, you will get the output. The flip-flop output you can see on the data. So previously we used data, to write a data, data line we have used to write the data in the flip-flop. Once row and column should be 1, write signal is 0, then flip-flop content will be visible here. Flip-flop content will be visible here. Okay, so now you can observe the output. So in this way, whenever whichever flip-flop you want, first select column and row 1, so that particular flip-flop will be selected. Then you issue write signal 1, then this MUX will allow you to feed the data from data line to the flip-flop. Then you make write equal to 0, so that this tri-state buffer will be enabled and Q you can watch on the data line. So this is how a parallel scan works. So next one, here we have shown this one, one MUX and one flip-flop. You can see here, one MUX here and flip-flop is shown. How we can implement this? So one MUX and flip-flop, in that MUX you will have two input, D and SI, and one flip-flop will be there. So how we can implement it is very simple. How it is done is, you have transmission gates. This is nothing but the transmission gates. This part, if you observe, this is nothing but 2:1 MUX, where the two input are D and SI, and scan is the select line. So whenever select line equal to 0, that time this transmission gate will be enabled and data will come out here. When scan equal to 1, then second data will be selected and you will get here. That you will get here. Okay. Now this 5 and 5 bar, this is nothing but the clock signal. So this flip-flop is realized by this part. That means the one stage, this is the one stage. This is the second stage. It is something like a master slave flip-flop. So this flip-flop, the master part is this one, transmission gate to inverter, that will form a master, and one more transmission gate and this will form the slave. So whenever phi equal to 0, the master will be enabled, the data will be stored here. When phi equal to 0, slave will be enabled, and whatever data stored in this, that will be taken into consideration and Q you will get. So it is something like a master slave flip flop. So you have a MUX and master slave flip flop. So this is how you can design the flip flop and MUX. This memory element, the flip flop and MUX, can be realized like this. This is the scannable register design. So your memory you have to modify. In the memory element, you should have MUX also, and you should have master slave flip-flop also. This is how it is designed. Next one, the last technique of DFT, design for testability, is BIST. So BIST means built-in self-test. So built-in self-test, if you consider a typical testing environment, you will have one test pattern generator, then the device under test, and you will have output analysis. You produce the all possible input combination, and you will get all the output response. Now output response should be compared with the whatever required output. When they match, and you will tell the chip is correct. So this is the complete testing scenario. So in the BIST, what happens in the regular circuit itself, you will provide all these facility, mainly two facility. One is test vector generation, another one is output analysis. So you will generate test vector in the circuit itself. So you will not use separate tester device. This will be in the regular circuit only. So there you will produce all the possible test vector, and also you have to do, or there should be facility to check the output. Output should be compared with the required one. When it matches, there should be some indicator telling that the work circuit is working properly or not. So that is what written here. Test generation and output analysis are included in the regular circuit itself. That is called built-in self-test. So one is you have to generate test vector. For that, pseudo-random sequence generator will be used. Okay, so that is used to generate the test vector. We will see that what is that pseudo-random sequence generator. And the next one, you have to analyze the output. So analyze the output means, usually if you store all the possible combination of the output, or output for all combination of input, then the output bit stream will be very large. So you have to store a large number of output bits to compare. So what is done is, instead of storing the complete output bits, you store only the compact form of the output bits. So that compact form will have lesser number of bits. So instead of storing the required output, you store the signature or the compact version of the output. So whenever you give the test vector and you get the output, you find the signature every time whenever you get a new data, and compare that signature with the required signature. So instead of comparing the complete output, you will compare the compact form of the output. That is called signature analysis. That also we will see in the coming slides. So what is this PRS chip, pseudo random generator, sequence generator? This is generated or designed using linear feedback shift register, using LFSR, and those LFSR is nothing but serial connection of flip-flops, and there will be XOR gate, and XOR gate is fed with the output of the flip-flop. So we will see that diagram, and they are described by a polynomial indicating which bits are to be fed. So we will see in the next one. So this is the typical linear feedback shift register. Here you have three flip-flops and one XOR gate is there, and one more additional AND gate is provided. This is for avoiding that 0-0 condition. So we will not worry about this AND gate. Let us concentrate only XOR and flip-flop. So this AND gate is not mandatory. Okay. So what happens here? There are three flip-flops, nothing but a shift register, and output of the first flip-flop and third flip-flop are connected to the XOR, and this XOR output feeds your shift register. Now the question is, how many flip-flops we will use, and what are the, or which flip-flop output you are going to feed in a feedback? So that has to be specified clearly. So that can be specified using the polynomial. So what is polynomial? 1 plus x plus x cube. So this highest term, whatever there, that indicates how many number of flip-flops you have to use. So that means 3 flip-flops you have to use, and out of 3, the last flip-flop output has to be there in the feedback. So you can see that third flip-flop output is fed back, and other input also you have to feed, that is x. So what is done? X means output of the first flip-flop. So output of the first flip-flop, output of the third flip-flops are connected via this XOR gate. Suppose if the equation is something like this, 1 plus x square plus x cube, then XOR output will be the second flip-flop output and third flip-flop output. They are connected to the XOR. Okay. So this x term or power of x indicates which flip-flop output you have to consider. This is a LFSR, and you can see here once value is stored, when you give n number of clock pulses, you will get a sequence of outputs, and there will be maximum possible is 2 power n minus 1. After that it repeats. Suppose 3 bit means 8 possible combination, 0 0 0 condition if you ignore, then there will be 7 possible output, and you will get random sequence there, and that will repeat. It's a periodic. Okay, so that is what is used to generate the test vector. Okay, so using this you can generate a 3 bit, so if there is a circuit with 3 inputs, there you can generate test vector from this LFSR. Okay, this output can be connected as a test vector to the device under test. Okay, now what do you mean by signature analysis? Signature analysis means you will find compact version of the output. So it uses data compaction technique to reduce the long data stream bits in a unique code called signature. So instead of comparing the output, you compare the signature. So signatures are calculated every time when circuit produces output. They can be created using data streams by feeding the data into n bit LFSR. So what is this? This input is coming from the device under test. So device under test outputs are fed to this signature analysis block. What is the signature analysis block? It is same. You have a shift register and XOR. That is nothing but a LFSR. You feed the data. You feed the data from the circuit DUT, device under test, and apply n number of clock pulses. So then the residue, whatever is remaining in the shift register, that denotes the signature. So you have to feed the output in the proper sequence. And after passing through all the output bits, whatever remaining in the shift register, that will tell the signature. So it may be something like you have 8 bits here, your output have 8 bits, you serially pass that all the outputs in a particular order you pass. So after that clock pulses, that many number of clock pulses, last if n bit is 3 bit, if you take 3 bit shift register is used, and the last remaining 3 bits of the shift register tell the signature. So instead of storing 8 outputs, what I am doing, I am storing only 3 bits only. So that will be unique to the input stream, this input stream. Okay, this is how you will use signature analysis to compare the output. So feedback consists of XORing selected taps of the shift register with input serial data. It is called LFSR. After a data stream has been clocked through, a residue of the serial data is left in the shift register. This residue is unique to the data stream and represents signature. But however, you have to consider one thing. You are mapping a large number of bits to a small number of bits, that is called signature. So there may be many output bit stream, they may be mapping to the same signature. So that one is there, but anyhow we can simplify the testing procedure here. So this is about the signature analysis. Now the last topic, we will take an example for BIST architecture. So one example is built-in logic block observation or logic block observer. It is also called BILBO. So it is an example, 3-bit built-in logic block observer is considered. So you can see 3 flip-flops, 1, 2, 3 flip-flops, and you have XOR gate and it is driven by two AND gates. The each individual AND gate will have a control signal C of 0, C of 1, and shift serial input is fed here and serial output is taken from here. And you have a parallel output also Q0, Q1, Q2. It will operate in many modes, four modes you have. So each one we will discuss. Okay. So let us consider that built-in logic block. Okay. So first one we will consider, that is 0 and 0 we will consider. So 0 and 0. So what happens, 0 means this select line will be 0, that means SI is selected. Since this one is 0, the AND gate one input will be 0 bar, 0 bar means it is 1, and whatever data is there, its complement is considered here. So SI bar, serial data, whatever you give, its complement is connected. And since C0 is 0 and C1 is 0, so this AND gate output will be 0 always. So what you get here is XOR gate, XOR of S1 bar and 0, that is nothing but S1 bar only you will get. So what is stored, S1 bar will be stored. Similarly, the Q0 bar is stored in this flip-flop and Q1 bar is stored in this flip-flop. So it and output you will get serial output. So this acts like a scan mode, that means serial, it takes the data from serial in and gives the output SO. It is a serial in and serial out. You can use it in the scan mode. So when C of 0, C1 is 0, this behaves like a serial in, serial out, scan shift register. Okay. Now, if we consider the next mode, that is 0, 1 mode, if you consider C of 0 equal to 1 and C of 1 equal to 0. So what is this mode? You are giving data 1 here, that means this data is considered. Since C of 0 is 1, so this will be 1, this will be 1, this will be 1. Since C of 1 equal to 0 means this AND gate is enabled, because here 0 bar, 0 bar and 0 bar. So what happens now? Whatever feedback is there, this feedback is considered and its complement will be taken. Feedback, whatever value, its complement will be taken and it is fed with XORing with the D of 0. D of 0 you will get here. So you will XOR D of 0 and feedback value and you feed it to the flip-flop. Similarly here, this is D1 and Q0 bar. Their XOR of this one is calculated and fed it to the second flip-flop. Similarly, the third flip-flop is nothing but Q1 bar and D of 2. So XOR of these two are fed in the third flip-flop. So it acts like a test mode. That means you are taking data, 3 bit data you are taking, that is D0, D1 and D2, and you are having a linear feedback shift register also, because this the data considered is the feedback data. So totally this block acts like a signature analysis. It takes output. In the previous example we consider only one output stream, but here you have three output stream. One is a D0, another one is D1, another one is D2. So every time you feed three output here, they are XORed with the feedback value and you will get a signature. After all the data have been clocked through, the residue of the flip-flops is nothing but the signature. So it is something like a parallel signature. You are finding signature of the three output bit stream. In the previous case we consider only one output stream. So you can see here, let me show that. See, here you have considered only one output stream. So in this case we are considering D0, D1, D2 and they are XORed with the feedback value. This is called test mode. So this is called test mode. Scan mode means serial in, serial out. Test mode means There will be a linear feedback and D0, D1, D2 values are considered and they are XORed with the feedback. Okay, so that is about the second mode. Let us consider the third mode, that is reset mode. So what happens in the reset? You have to give reset. Reset means C1 will be 1. So this will be 1, this value, and this will be 0. This will be 0. So everywhere 1 means 1 bar will be applied to the AND gate. You are applying 1, so an AND gate receives 1 bar. So that means AND gate, one of the input is 0, so output is 0. Output is AND gate output is 0, AND gate output 0. And also this AND gate output also will be 0 because you are giving C of 0 equal to, C of 0 is nothing but 0 you are giving. So this also 0, this also 0. So XOR is receiving 2 zeros. So output of the XOR will be 0, 0, 0. So all flip-flops will receive 0, 0, 0. So this is nothing but the reset. So now you will reset all the flip-flops. Okay. So that is a simple, this one is simple. Next, consider the last mode, that is 1-1. So we will consider 1-1. 1-1 means this is 1, this is 1. So here 1-1 means you will consider all the data. You will consider all the data. So that means D of 0, D of 1 and D of 2 you will consider. And next one is the next one value. This is 1. What is that? C of 1 is 1 means you can see here C1 is connected to here. That means this is 0. This XOR will get D of 0 and 0. So here D of 1 and 0. And this is D of 2 and 0. Because this AND gate output all 0. Why? Because your C1 is 1. So you get these 3 0. 0 is XORed with the D0, D1 and D2. And that is fed here. That is fed. So that means this works like a parallel in serial out. Parallel in means these 3 data are fed. They are considered and serial shift will take place. Okay. So it acts like a normal operation, means a parallel in parallel out or serial out also you can tell. If you take output from here, it is serial output. Okay. So last mode is simple. Now we will see where is the application of this logic, built-in logic block observer. So this is what we observed. One is 0-0 scan mode. You can, if you know the truth table of AND gate, XOR gate, you can find out its mode and its operation. Okay, it's simply finding the output of each gate. So 0-1 means it is test. That means it will find its signature. Scan 0 means it will behave like a serial in serial out, and reset means all the output will be 0. 1-1 means it is parallel in parallel out. So where we can use this one? This can be used in this way. So if you have a circuit here, so you can I will show, let me show this one. 1 minute. Yes, here. So what is this? You have this complete one bilbo. You have one bilbo you have, and you have your device under test, and you have one more bilbo you have here. Bilbo you have. Now what happens? The first bilbo is configured to generate the random test vector. So you know the 4 modes here. Random test vector can be generated from a LFSR. So you can use it as a LFSR and generate a pseudo random pattern generator. So it will produce all the test vector required to test the bit. And second bilbo, the same bilbo, one more copy we will take, but that we will configure it as a signature analysis mode. Signature analysis mode, that means it will be in the test mode. So this will be in the scan mode and this will be in the test mode. So now what you will do, you will, one will generate all the possible test vector, another will find the signature. So this nothing but a built-in self-test. You have generated the test vector, you have found the signature. So in this way, this Bilbo structure can be used in a BIST architecture. Okay, so application of Bilbo is, you can either use it generating the test vector, or you can use it to find the signature. So output analysis. So in this way, you can use the this Bilbo. Okay. So that is about the topics which are included in the testing. Thank you.